Hey, class. I'm Paul. I know you guys haven't seen me in person yet, except for a couple of you. And so what I wanted to do is tape a version of the lecture that I give my in-class sections about Platoon and give you a little context about why we watched it and what we're going to do with it next. Before we start, I do want to make an announcement about the quiz. Some of you contacted me with a little bit of anxiety because you have a 10 on the quiz. All that means is you got the first question right. The first question, because it's multiple choice, is set to be auto-graded by Brightspace. The rest of your quizzes are waiting for me to go in there and grade the other 9 questions. And I've started that process today, and I'll have it finished by the end of this week. So that's what's going on with that. And the other little writing assignment I had you do connected to Platoon, that was just, that's going to be graded credit, no credit. It's kind of a free 10 points, just because I wanted to get to you guys to thinking about the scene I'm going to talk about primarily, and all the details. So when I'm talking about it in about, you know, 10 minutes here or so, it's not completely cold for you guys. Okay, so let's start by just a quick kind of discussion of the context of the film. Is obviously the Vietnam War, and I'm going to give you about a 30-second super summarized and condensed version of what's going on in the Vietnam War. The U.S. forces there are fighting the North Vietnamese army, what's referred to frequently in the film as the NVA. Okay, this is a normal army with uniforms and divisions and battalions and platoons, you know, the same structures that all official armies the world over have. And that's who they're fighting in, like, that final scene, the big climactic final scene. They're fighting the North Vietnamese. But one of the things going on in Vietnam is there's a second enemy, a hidden enemy, called alternately Charlie or the VC or the Viet Cong. And these are people who are South Vietnamese in location, but they are sympathetic to the communist regime. And they don't have uniforms and they don't have structures. It's a guerrilla army that literally blends within the Vietnamese and blends within the countryside. And so that's always in the back of any soldier fighting in Vietnam, that issue of we have an enemy that we can't readily identify the way you can the NVA. And that's what's influencing the village scene. I mean, that's why all the soldiers are on edge, the idea that this may be a village that is sympathetic to the Viet Cong. And there are lots of markers in the scene to reinforce that idea, which we'll get to when we talk about the village scene. So that's just the basic context of the war. But although this is a movie set during the Vietnam War, I would argue this is not a war film. You know, there are plenty of war movies about the Vietnam War. You know, Hamburger Hill, for example, comes to mind. And these are just like any other war movie that happen to be set in Vietnam. And they deal with issues and themes that you find in war movies, you know, the Brotherhood of Soldiers, that kind of thing. Platoon seems to be doing something else. I mean, it certainly does some of that, but it seems to have a different focus. And what that focus is primarily is trying to explain certain behaviors. For those of you who may not know, Platoon was a wildly successful film. It won the Oscar for Best Picture in 1986 and Best Director and Best Supporting Actor. I think Tom Berenger won an Oscar as well. He was certainly nominated. I'm pretty sure he won. And that's the guy playing Barnes. But the director, Oliver Stone, was a soldier in Vietnam, and his experiences are given to the character Chris. And, you know, not 100%, obviously, you know, Oliver Stone didn't go kill his staff sergeant in Vietnam, but the experiences that Chris has in the village are experiences Oliver Stone experienced. And so one of the things I think the film is trying to do is trying to understand that. How can I be guilty of doing something like that. And so that's what we kind of want to tailor this discussion on. So I think the main focus of the film, and this is what I was getting at with the final question of the quiz, what is the main conflict? A lot of you wrote that the main conflict is within the platoon, between the Barnes side and the Elias side. And that's an answer that's a perfectly good answer, and it received full credit. And there's a lot in the film to support that. And we're gonna spend some time looking at that. And it's important to note the film is called Platoon, right? It's not called Vietnam. It's not called, you know, Hamburger Hill. It's called Platoon, which is the director, the artist, trying to focus your attention on the platoon, Makes sense, right? That's why it's a title. Okay, so this is a platoon that's ostensibly led by the character Lieutenant Wolf. Okay, clear vacuum of leadership. Okay, this is not an effective leader. This is a person who came right out of West Point, learned about war in textbooks, and doesn't have any real experience and doesn't have leadership qualities. And that power vacuum is what allows for the platoon to split into Team Barnes and Team Elias. And I don't want to spend too much time on Wolf other than these introductory comments, but it, just to ground myself in the text, which is what you always want to do when you're analyzing something. You don't want to just make a claim. You want to then ground yourself in the thing itself and say, here's where I'm getting that idea. The scene that really kind of crystallizes the idea that Wolf doesn't know what he's doing and is incapable of leading the platoon is about midway through the film when he calls down the airstrike on his own men. Okay, it's a nice, real clear symbol. This is not a guy that we can trust to lead. So within that power vacuum, like I said, you have Barnes and you have Elias. So we're gonna start talking about Barnes first. Barnes is a fairly brutal, results-oriented sergeant, a very good soldier. And if you pay attention to a lot of his the things he says, some really interesting lines, like in the village scene when Elias shows up, he tells Elias, this isn't your show. Of course, the implication being, this is my show. And there are several times in the movie he refers to the Vietnam War as my war. There's one point where he tells Elias, don't tell me how to run my war. Okay, so we have that kind of figure and character on one side. And then on the other side, of course, you have Elias. Actually, I'll get to that in a second. The line in the movie I think captures Elias best is a line he utters in the underworld when he says, feeling good is good enough. Okay, so those are the two sides. But it's really important we understand this is not a simple binary of good and evil, which we'll get to later. I'm not suggesting Barnes is not evil. He clearly is. But the film is not going for overly simplistic binaries, is my point. And I'll explain what I mean with good and evil in a little bit. But it's also not making a simple binary between Barnes and Elias, where Barnes is warrior and Elias is pacifist. It's important to remember, Elias is a really good soldier too. He's really good at killing Vietnamese people, or Vietnamese soldiers in the war. And there's that scene where he's just running through the jungle on his own, you know, mowing them down. So he's not a pacifist. He's not anti-war. This is not going in those directions. It's more of how to proceed with the war is the conflict between Elias and Barnes. Before we get any further, I want to just talk a little bit about the characters who are on each side, just so we know who we're talking about. In the group that I'm calling Team Barnes, okay, you have O'Neill, who's one of the other sergeants, okay? He's the one played by John C. McGinley. He spends the entire movie sucking up to Barnes. I mean, he's a complete kiss ass. And that seems to be, I mean, he's not a character of great moral strength. He's just going along kissing up to Barnes in the hopes that it will have some benefit for him. And of course, that comes to fruition at the end when he finally asks Barnes for a favor. At the end, so can you let me out of this final battle? I've got R&R 3 days. Can you get me out of here early? Thinking after all I've done, Barnes will give me this. I'm one of Barnes's guys. Only to be told in fairly cold-blooded terms, we all have to die sometime. So that's a nice little insight into what I'm calling Team Barnes. That there isn't any loyalty, even though these are all Team Barnes characters. There's no real loyalty between them. It's just whatever's expeditious at the moment. But Barnes doesn't care about O'Neill. Barnes doesn't care about anybody. Right before that scene, if you remember, he's basically being very, very cruel to another Team Barnes character who's Junior. Okay, Junior is the guy who's always throwing everyone off under the bus. It's always somebody else's fault. It's never Junior's fault. And when he can't find someone to blame, he immediately goes to kind of this reflexive kind of race relation thing, as opposed to some of the other African-American characters who voice like kind of legitimate race relation issues in the late 60s. You know, King comes to example, where King has that conversation early in the film with Chris about, you know, you have to be rich to even think like you are, Chris. I mean, we're always getting the short end. That's just how it works. Which is much more measured and kind of realistic and not trying, whereas Junior's just constantly using it to kind of blame everybody but himself. And while we're on that scene, a real interesting sidebar, one of the things that you may have noticed about the film is the language. You almost can't not notice it. Like literally, I think the first line in the movie is the only line without a curse word. We have Gardner saying, you know, oh man, is that what I think it is? And then boom, the next line you've got cursing and it goes nonstop. The reason that happens, of course, is because this is a war film and this is a film with soldiers, and that's, you know, how soldiers talk, right? There's the reality component to it. But the thing about language I want to talk about real quick in relation to the scene I just mentioned is the dehumanizing language that the film has towards the Vietnamese. They're alternately called dinks or gooks throughout the film. And again, that's reality-based. That's how Vietnam soldiers would refer to the Vietnamese enemy. But it's important to say a few words about why that happens. And it's not unique to United States, U.S. soldiers in Vietnam. It's not unique to U.S. soldiers anywhere else. It's unique to all soldiers in every war. There's these kind of derogatory terms they use for the enemy with the goal of dehumanizing the enemy. And the reason for that in a war is quite practical. You don't have soldiers built up with the kind of guilt and remorse and hesitation and moral qualms about killing people, because you know you're not killing people, you're killing whatever the term you have for the enemy is. So that's in the film just for reality reasons. But in the scene I'm talking about between Barnes and Junior at the end, it's interesting because this is the first time you see one of our characters use those terms on another U.S. soldier. Or there's the scene where, and you might have missed it because there's a lot going on in the scene, but Barnes drops the N-word on Junior. And so, and I think the relevance of that scene is to show that Barnes dehumanizes everybody, just kind of his nature. And so going back to Team Barnes, then there's Bunny. Okay, Bunny is just a psychopath who is let loose in this arena of war. And, you know, he's the one who, when in the village, when Chris steps back from the precipice, Bunny's right there, steps right in and immediately kills the handicapped child and mother. And does it with this kind of weird glee. Like, if you remember, the first thing he says is, you know, holy shit, have you ever seen a head come apart that way? Which is really interesting if you kind of spend a moment on it, you know, be horrified by hearing it, but then spend some time thinking about it. The only way you could ever utter that sentence is if you've seen other heads split open, right? It can't be your first one, because you would have nothing to compare it to, nothing to go, wow, that was different. So that's a very telling line about Bunny. And there are all these other little moments, like when the village is burning and all the characters are walking away and he's taking photos of it. Like, this is something wonderful. We know he's killed at least two other people in the village because you see their bodies as he's lighting the hut on fire. Later in the film, when they're flying over the scene again, he's got this big grin on his face, right? This is exciting to him. And then there's the great scene at the end, not great as in what a wonderful guy, but just a really powerful kind of perfectly crafted scene where right before that big battle, he's in the foxhole with Junior and he says, I don't think we've done anything wrong here. And as a viewer, you got to be taken aback and going, wait, what? You've killed and raped indiscriminately, including most of the people we've seen you shoot are civilians, and you don't think there's anything wrong with that. So just complete unfettered psychopath. Now, there are two other characters I just want to point out briefly on the Team Barnes side. We don't get their names. I mean, obviously they have names, and if you went to the credits, they'd have names, but they're never referred to by name in the film. One of them is a guy, he's got the spade on his helmet, and he gets two lines in the movie. And they're both in the village scene. When Barnes is interrogating the village elder and says, you know, he's VC, he knows what I'm saying, they cut to this guy. And he's like, you're goddamn right he does. And then soon as Barnes kills the woman, he immediately says to Barnes, let us get in on this. You know, let us start killing people too. And then right next to him in that same scene is a guy who looks amazingly like Doc in the film. They look amazingly alike, almost like you think it's the same actor. And the only way you can tell apart is Doc has always got the yellow tourniquet stock on his shoulder. And he's also very, very interested in immediately killing people in the village. He's the first one to say, shoot this guy, and then see someone else talks. When Barnes says, go get the guy, the scout he just shot, his face is beatific. It's like orgasmic. He's so excited. He's like, yeah. So these are the characters on what I'm calling Team Barnes. And before we delve further into the village scene, I want to talk about, you know, Team Elias. Okay, obviously, there's Chris, okay, the film's main character. There's a character named Ra. He's the one who kind of is the king of the underworld. He's got a throne made out of sandbags, constantly giving advice. You've got King, who's the one who really first takes Chris under his wing, rechristens him. You know, Taylor was shot. This is Chris. He's been resurrected. You've got Francis, who's the character Chris is with in the foxhole in the final battle. You've got Big Harold, played by a very, very young Forrest Whitaker. You've got Lerner, played by an even younger and just flat out adorable Johnny Depp. He looks so young. He's so young, you just want to pinch his cheeks. You've got Crawford, who's the surfer guy. You've got Doc, as we mentioned, and you've got Manny. Now, the first thing you do when you split the teams up is you realize there's a lot more characters on Team Elias. Why is that? And I would suggest the reason is because this is a film told from Chris's perspective. And Chris is on Team Elias, what we're calling Team Elias. So obviously he's going to have more relationships with these characters than the other characters. So those are the signs. And getting back to the village scene. And the village scene is obviously, I don't think I'm saying anything you haven't figured out already. The village scene is the pivotal scene in the movie. Okay, this is where we get the we understand the nature of the contrasts between these two groups of people. And it has everything to do with a moral compass. Okay, if Barnes has, this is the scene that makes it clear, Barnes does not have a moral compass anymore. Okay, he has lost it in the exigencies of combat. Okay, and it's important to remember two things in the village scene about related to Barnes. One is he does not kill the woman for a even vaguely military reason. Okay, that's the daughter, where he puts the gun to the daughter's head to try to get information from the elder. That he kills the woman, if you remember, because she's annoying him. Okay. And it's not also, it's important to note, that's not the first person he kills in the village scene. There's a scene right before that where he drops a white phosphorus grenade into a hole, and we see there are still two children in the hole. He just doesn't care, right? It's not, and I'm not suggesting he knew they were in there. He didn't care to look, right? He's just, I just want to raise this village to the ground, kind of thing. And obviously all the other characters on Team Elias, they still have a moral compass. It's not like they don't want to win the war. In fact, it's even more complex than that. Elias, by this point in 1968, he's been fighting for 3 years. He's come to the recognition that they're not going to win this war, yet he's still fighting it, which is an interesting kind of sense of nobility there, that his sense of purpose doesn't waver from the fact that he sees the writing on the wall that, you know, the way we're fighting this war is costing us something we can't afford to pay, which is what Barnes represents. And the reason why that's such a pivotal scene is not only does that crystallize the conflict between the platoon, but it shows you the conflict within the individual. And that's what I think, if I was taking the quiz, that's how I would answer question 10. And a few of you did. And I'm not saying if you said the platoon, you're wrong. There are competing answers here. I think the main conflict is within the individual soldiers of the platoon, illustrated most prominently by Chris, you know, between the Barnes emotions and the Elias emotions. And Chris in the village scene steps right up to the edge, where he is torturing and tormenting a handicapped, physically and mentally handicapped Vietnamese child. And he's doing it, as he tells Francis in that scene, because he's scared and he needs an outlet. And of course, Bunny is right there encouraging him. But Chris steps away from the edge in that pivotal scene. Bunny, of course, finishes it off. So I think that's the primary kind of tension, that we're supposed to understand that while we're seeing it through Chris, this is the same struggle going through all of the members of the platoon. Some of them decide real quickly how they're going to be. You know, Bunny, I imagine Bunny's wrestling was like 3 seconds, and Junior's was a little longer, and O'Neill's is a little longer, but they've made their decisions. And a lot of the other people are still wrestling with that, and certainly Chris is. So let me take a quick drink. So while the village scene is the most pivotal scene in the film, I'm going to argue it's not the central scene. The central scene is the one I asked you to go back and look at, the underworld scene, early in the film. It's about half an hour in. And this is the scene we're really going to kind of tear open and play with. And because I think this is the central scene. This is the scene that sets up everything else. The village scene isn't pivotal the way it is without this scene. So any sense of the overall film, what you're supposed to make of this film, has to deal with the underworld and the barracks scene, because they're right, you know, the right side by side. You see what we're calling Team Elias in the underworld, and you're seeing Team Barnes up on top in the barracks. So I asked you guys to go back and look at that, and that's what that writing assignment was about. So when you do, let's start talking about the details. First of all, the details in the scenes. Okay, we've already covered who's there. But when you go in the underworld, again, because the film refuses simple divisions, these are not people who are disillusioned or naive about where they are. The underworld is full of skulls. You know, some of them are candles, some of them just hang around. So these are people who are celebrating and blowing off steam, literally surrounded by reminders of death. Okay, they're not under any illusions of where they are. They're just trying to figure out a way to deal with it that keeps their moral compass. You go to the barracks, one of the details that's most prominent in the background as Lieutenant Wolf is walking through is a Confederate flag. Again, a nice visual reminder of the Civil War within the platoon, but also, you know, in the late 60s and, you know, unfortunately to some degree today still, it's a symbol of hate and intolerance. So you have that. And you might say, okay, well, hey, Paul, you're reading too much into it. It's just a flag. It's just, you know, something in the background. And yeah, but you have to remember Oliver Stone chose to put it in the scene, right? And it's not like, you know, Warner Brothers execs are calling him saying, hey, you have to figure out a way to get a Confederate flag in there somewhere. When he's setting up that scene, because he wrote and directed the film, he's putting it in there and it's there for a reason. It's a detail he's incorporating intentionally. So as we're trying to analyze the film and make sense of it, it's something we have to pay attention to. Pay attention to the interactions between these characters. Down in the underworld, it's a community. Okay, they're dancing together, they're singing together. They're actually, not only are they smoking pot, but there are a couple of cases where they're like using each other to increase their high. There's a scene where Johnny Depp's character is hotboxing somebody and blowing the smoke into a gas mask. And then there's the shotgun scene between Elias and Chris. So everything there is done as a group and is communal. Up in the barracks, there is no real community. There are no characters who are together. They're always in their own space, even around the poker table. There's no real community. And if you pay attention to how they treat each other, they're all just cutting each other down. Right from the initial conversation between Junior and Bunny is just insult driven. Then the next scene you get is a guy throwing a knife right at the feet of another guy. And, you know, obviously I'm not suggesting he's trying to hurt him, but it's just that action. You've get, the poker game. They're immediately, you know, insulting, making fun of the lieutenant. And then as soon as he leaves, they talk behind his back. So there's no community there. It's just insult driven. In fact, the nicest thing someone says to anybody in the barracks scene is when Junior tells Bunny, well, you're a killer. That's the nicest thing anyone says, which is not, you know, which is not terribly nice. And then there are the activities, right? We already talked about in the underworld, they're dancing and they're singing. And they're smoking a whole lot of marijuana, a whole lot. Okay. Contrast that with up top. They're not smoking marijuana up top. They're drinking alcohol, mostly beer, and then there's some whiskey. Okay. And if you take a moment to think about what that kind of difference, what that contrast does to inform these groups of people, you see it fits with a lot of the other things we've been talking about. Alcohol is a substance that dulls the senses. Okay. Whereas marijuana is a drug that expands consciousness. Okay. And you can see how that fits with these characters and how they've been approaching things that we've already talked about. And the final detail in this scene that you want to pay attention to is the soundtrack. Again, the underworld scene has White Rabbit by Jefferson Airplane playing in the background. And one of the things I've done is I've included the lyrics to White Rabbit to our Brightspace page under content for week six. If you want to, you know, maybe pause this, go listen to the song with the lyrics in front of you, or do this later. What you'll see, in addition to being just a really good tune, it's a song that is making heavy use of Alice in Wonderland imagery, and there's a whole lot of psychedelic drugs being referenced in the song. Again, things that expand your consciousness. And when a quick sidebar, when I'm saying expand your consciousness, that is, this is not me advocating or endorsing their use. This is just what the drug does. And then if you go to the soundtrack for the barracks, it's Merle Haggard's Okie from Muskogee. Again, a great song. And again, I put the lyrics on our content page if you want to go ahead and follow along or listen to it later. And it's real interesting how Stone is using that. Like literally the first sounds you hear in the barracks is the first line of the song. We don't smoke marijuana in Muskogee. And the very image you saw before you hear that, of course, is the people in the underworld smoking marijuana. And the whole song is very exclusionary. It's a list of, these are the things we don't do, okay? The singer of the song is defining himself by what he doesn't do, not in terms of what he does, to a large extent. It's a song that basically suggests that unquestioning respect for authority is required. We still respect the college dean, those kind of things. The only substance intoxicant mentioned in the song is white lightning, a reference to moonshine, which brings us back to the alcohol in the barracks. And there's that line at the end of the first stanza, we believe in living right. And, right, and again, to me, that immediately echoes Barnes, who at one point in the film, when he visits the underworld, you know, there are two interesting things he says there that you see they're analogs in the song. First, he talks about the smoking of marijuana and says, oh, you guys smoke this to escape from reality. Not me. I am reality. And then later in that same scene, he says, I have no problem with somebody who does what he's told. Okay. It's a lot like we believe in living right. But the song, again, makes clear there's only one definition of living right, and that's by doing these things, by not questioning authority and that kind of stuff. So you see how both songs kind of reinforce who these characters are and how they're approaching each other and the war in the film. And again, you might say, well, Paul, come on, they're just songs. But you have to remember, Oliver Stone didn't just have a big bin that he spun around and said, oh, what song am I gonna use? Oh, I'm using White Rabbit. He's picking that song for a reason, because it matches some of the themes he wants to play with in that scene and in the film. So that means as we're trying to make sense of this, we have to pay attention to those as details that are included. Okay, hopefully that makes sense. Okay, one of the other things you want to do as you're going through this is pay attention to contrasts, things that seem opposite, but similar enough where like there's a mirror shade. I'll give you a few examples of what I mean. Neither character is very, very deeply developed, but there's a character on Team Elias that we said there's Doc, and then there's a character on Barnes who's not named. They look almost identical. That's a contrast I would pay attention to when I'm trying to make sense of this film. I would go to the foxhole scenes at the end. they're literally side by side. You have the first one, you have Junior and Bunny in a foxhole. And Junior bails. He just runs. The action's getting too heavy, and he leaves his fellow soldiers, fox mate, partner, to face the music alone. And that's when Bunny gets killed. And Junior gets killed shortly after. Sandwiched between that scene are two scenes with Chris and Francis in the foxhole. In the first one, a survivor of the ambush crawls in and says, hey, there's a whole bunch of NBA right behind me. You guys got to get out of here. And then he leaves. And Francis says, let's go. Chris says, you go, I'm staying. Okay, very clear difference between what we saw with Junior. Francis stays. Even though he's terrified, he stays. He feels an obligation to his foxhole mate, his friend, and his fellow soldier. He stays. And then we get the Bunny Junior scene. And then we go back a little bit later to Chris and Francis in the foxhole. And this is after the foxhole's been blown up, and Chris and Francis are off in some bush. And then Chris runs back to the foxhole and starts shooting. At that point, Francis is a free agent. I mean, he could just stay in the bush. He could go back. He could retreat. But what he does, and again, in direct contrast to Junior, is he goes back to the blown up foxhole and fights alongside Chris. So you want to pay attention to those kind of things. Another interesting contrast is the very first scene in the movie, how both Elias and Barnes interact with Chris. You know, Barnes is really getting on him and insulting him for cramping up and not knowing what he's doing. He said, the line is, you are a simple son of a bitch, Taylor. Whereas immediately after that, Elias shows up and tries to figure out why he's cramping. Oh, you're carrying too much stuff. You don't need all this. I'll carry it for you. But next time, check with me. So you only take what you need. You know, it's a more nurturing kind of relationship. You also want to pay attention to something that's called anomalies, an idea I'll get back to in a bit, but things that don't fit, things that are off or don't make sense. I'll give you two examples of what I mean from the film. The first is the attempted rape scene. In the village scene, there's an attempted rape of a couple of Vietnamese girls. Bunny is there, Junior is there, and some other two other characters. And Chris stumbles upon it and stops the rape. One of the guys who's trying to rape the girl, this is the guy who looks like Doc, by the way, who just doesn't have a name. Or if he does, in the 200 times I've watched the film, I've missed it. It's almost central in when the rape scene starts, when Chris walks upon it, it's almost centered in the film, in the screen, is a cross dangling from this character. So in the middle of a rape, you've got this idea of a Christian cross. I mean, that's a pretty clear analogy that, okay, if you are indeed a Christian to the point where you wear Christian iconography, there's a very clear point you're missing if you're engaged in this kind of behavior. So that's an anomaly. That's something I would pay attention to. The other one that works well is looking at Bunny. If you notice, he carries a very distinct weapon in the film. He carries a shotgun. He's the only character in the movie that does it. That's what makes him stand out. That's why you notice, say, oh wait, he's the only character doing this. And you might say, okay, well, that's interesting. But if you did just a little bit of research, you would realize that most of the world views the use of a shotgun in warfare as a war crime. The United States has long dismissed this, but this goes all the way back to World War I, where the German army filed formal complaints about US soldiers using shotguns and trenches and said this is a brutal weapon of war, which is really weird when you work your brains around it, that, you know, there's that kind of overlaying sense of civility in war that, oh, there are lines you don't cross, you know, including using a shotgun. US has always rejected that point of view, and I'm not here weighing in on saying they should or it isn't. I'm just saying this is the international kind of conversation about use of a shotgun. And so it's interesting that Stone gives it to Bunny, which kind of fits. Okay. So the last kind of topic I want to cover with the film before I get to just how we conduct analysis, how I got to all these points, is to emphasize very, very clearly that Stone in the film, these divisions are not neat and they are not simple. Okay, it's not just a situation of Team Barnes all bad. Well, let me rephrase. That is true. But Team Elias, all good. That is the part that's not so neat and simple. Again, Chris in the Village, you know, going right up to the Edge is an example. How a lot of the characters deal with the idea of cowardice. Okay, you've got, we talked about Junior, Team Barnes guy, just abandons his foxhole mate, an act of cowardice. And we respond negatively to it because we've, you know, by this point in the film, we've had an hour and a half of Junior, and this is not a character we like or are supposed to like. In that same battle, you have O'Neill wimping out, or not wimping out, but doing an act of cowardice, pulling a dead body over him and hiding throughout the battle. Again, because we're an hour and a half in, we've made some determinations about O'Neill. We don't like him. He's not a very likable guy. We respond negatively to that. But right before the battle, you have King telling Chris, it's okay to be a coward. There's no such thing as a coward out here. So, you know, it's interesting how we respond differently to King saying that and then seeing two characters kind of embody that, and we react negatively to it. And then the final point is after the battle, we see Francis engage in an act of coward, what could be called an act of cowardice. He stabs himself in the leg after the battle because he's already been wounded once. Second wound, he gets to go home. But I don't think we respond or are meant to respond the same way to that moment the way we do with O'Neill and Junior. And it is important to point out a major distinction is that Francis does this after the battle and not during the battle. But still, it's not a morally upstanding act by most standards to do that. I think probably really very real. Again, basing this in Stone's lived experience, but it's interesting how we react differently, but it does highlight the fact that these divisions in the film aren't very simple or neat. As Chris says in the final monologue, the war was within us. Okay, and that's where the central conflict is in the film, not US versus North Vietnamese, not even Elias versus Barnes, but the Barnes aspects and the Elias aspects within the individual, the pull of how do we conduct ourselves in this chaos and lunacy of battle? How do we keep our moral compass? And Chris's, the monologues, the monologues are really, really kind of honest and sincere and clear about that. You know, he's not pulling punches here. You know, there's a part of me that's always amazed that when Stone makes this film, he doesn't, I mean, if I was making this film about me, I don't know that I would keep Chris in the Village scene in it, because I would say, you know, I look really bad in that scene. So I'm always kind of impressed that Stone has that kind of self-awareness and self-honesty to say, no, this is how I behaved. And the monologues are similarly honest. You know, one of the final things Chris says is that I've often felt like the son of those two fathers. So that's a pretty clear statement of kind of that central conflict within him, and by extension, the other soldiers. But again, just getting back to this idea of it not being neat, if we play with that idea that Chris is the son of those two fathers, of Barnes and Elias, who wins? Who wins out? By the end of the film, who wins out, right? It's, some people would say Elias wins out because Chris has avenged his death and he's killed Barnes. I would suggest a different reading. I would suggest Barnes wins this pull for Chris's soul by the end of the film. Why? Well, the first thing is Barnes, the reason why we don't like Barnes, or the one act that we saw that kind of shows Barnes has lost his moral center, is an illegal killing. And the film ends with an illegal killing, Chris killing Barnes. Again, going back to this idea of repetition, if you pay attention very early in the movie, the first ambush scene, the first time we see Barnes kill somebody, he approaches a wounded North Vietnamese soldier who's lying on his side, tilted, leaning towards his back. Barnes shoots him 3 times in the chest. The final scene we're talking about, Barnes is on his side, leaning towards his back, the exact same position. Chris shoots him 3 times in the chest. So when I said you got to pay attention to repetitions, there's one that you see repeated. And if you start to wrestle with what that means, I think you get somewhere kind of interesting. And the last detail I point at to say Barnes is the one that wins the struggle is Chris's reaction as he's flying away. If you go back and watch, he breaks down into copious tears. Okay. And you could, we could explain this a different way if it was the, if that was the only detail, right? Because, oh, that's just, you know, all the tension built up from a year, almost a year in combat is kind of finally released and purged kind of thing. And that's certainly legitimate, a valid point. But when you blend that point with these other points, you start to see a picture arise of, oh, this is Chris's recognition that I have just become Barnes. Okay. We can assume he doesn't continue to be Barnes, otherwise you wouldn't have the monologues. But at that moment, at the end of the film, he's realized, oh, I've just done very Barnes thing. And the final point related to this is I'll remind you of what Ross says about Barnes when they're all deciding what to do about Elias's death. Ross tells everyone, Barnes has been shot 7 times. The only thing that can kill Barnes is Barnes. And I would suggest that's exactly what happens. Barnes, the role being played by Chris in this moment, Barnes kills Barnes. And I'll also remind you of two other kind of details that point to this, that the conflict's within the individual. One is the epigraph for the film. If you don't know what an epigraph is, you probably do, you just don't know what it's called, an epigraph. But an epigraph is like, what starts a film or a book, it's a piece of text that's always from another source before the movie or the film or the book starts. And it's a way of the author saying, hey, here's a theme I want to introduce to you because it's somehow relevant to the film or the book. In Platoon, the epigraph is rejoice, O man, in thy youth from Ecclesiastes. And the tagline for the film, and again, if you don't know what a tagline is, you probably do, you just might not have known that's what it's called. But if you go to a theater and they have these big movie posters along as you're walking in, these are the movies that are playing, these are the movies coming soon, yada, yada. And there's a line, they always have a line from the film, that's called a tagline. And the tagline for Platoon is, in front of me, I'll make sure I quote it right. In war, the first casualty is innocence. So you see how those two ideas kind of feed into what we've been talking about with Chris's character. So that's it. That's how I'm saying these scenes, these smaller parts of the film kind of inform the meaning of the whole. Because that's what analysis is at the end of the day, is we're breaking something down into its smaller component pieces and then seeing how they interact. So that's it. Now I want to talk about how I did it. And the reason I'm going to talk about how I did it is because you're going to do it next. So I'm going to share my screen, and 9 times out of 10, this works. And so hopefully this, I don't know if you can see that. Hopefully you can. It looks like you are. Good. So here's the method for analysis that I find most helpful. Okay, the first thing you want to do is look for details. Okay, don't worry about what they mean yet. Just look for them. Like we did in this discussion, we saw the Confederate flag, that's a detail. We looked at the soundtracks, that's a detail. We saw a skull candle, that's a detail. So, and when you're new to this, I would get a list. I would literally get paper and pen and make a list. Sometimes I still do that. I don't do it for Platoon just because I've done this so many times. And just start making a list of all the details you see. And don't be in a rush. Don't say, oh, okay, I've got 30, that's enough. Keep pushing. When you think you're done, do it a little more. Because the more details you find, the better your analysis is going to wind up being, because you're going to have more things to pull from. Okay. So that's the first thing. Get a list of details. Then go back and look for a specific kind of details. And I'm using go back intentionally. Don't do these things at the same time, because you're going to miss stuff. And you're not going to have as good an analysis. And you're not going to have as good a Paul can't speak. Paul speaks, take two. You're not going to have as good analysis than you want if you hurry this in or try to do two things at once. So after you got your list of details, go back and look for specific kinds. Look for repetitions, like we talked about already. Look for contrasts, like we talked about. Look for those binaries, things that are opposing, good, evil, light, dark, Barnes, Elias. See where that gets you. And then look for anomalies, like we already talked about as well. You know, what are things that stand out as out of place? Another good example is to go back to the barracks scene. And when Lieutenant Wolf walks in, his shirt he's wearing is so out of place from what everyone else is doing. So, okay, I would say that's an anomaly. I might go to Rodriguez, who's got his shrine, you know, his Catholic shrine, that says something about this individual that is not in line with any of his behavior. I would say, okay, that seems to be an anomaly. So do that as a second list of details. This list will be shorter than your first list. And then what you do down here at the bottom is you start to interrogate these details individually. Grab one. Okay, the Confederate flag. I'm going to deal with that. And literally start asking it, so what? Oh, there's a Confederate flag in there. So what? Well, the Confederate flag is most frequently associated historically with the Civil War. So what? Well, there seems to be a Civil War within the platoon. Okay, keep asking so what till you get to something that seems like an answer or an explanation like that. Oh, Civil War in the platoon, Civil War there. Okay, that seems to get you somewhere. Then stop and go into a different detail and do it again and keep doing this until what's going to happen is you're going to start to see a pattern emerge. A lot of your progressive answers to so what are starting to all start leading in a certain direction. And that direction is your interpretation. Okay, that's what you would have as your thesis. That would be how you explain the entire thing itself. And how did we get there? We got there by looking at individual details and really interrogating relevance. Not trying to predetermine it as you see the detail. You want to see it first, later on go back, ask it so what. And don't be satisfied with that answer. Ask so what that answer and keep doing it so you feel, okay, I've taken this one detail as far as I can. I think that's the end of that. So hopefully that makes some sense to you. If it doesn't, feel free to shoot me an email. I also now have a camera on campus in my office. I'm at home right now. So we can do office hours via Zoom now if you feel that would be something that's beneficial to you. So what's going to happen now is on our Brightspace page, I will have, like I said, I'll have links to White Rabbit, the song and the lyrics to Okie from Muskogee. I will put a real, basically what that one very simple document I just shared with you, I'm going to put that on Brightspace in case you didn't take notes or you missed something I said and you're tired of looking at Mike Schmidt over my shoulder and you don't want to watch this again, or you know, you don't want to look at my ugly shirts, whatever. You can just go ahead and look at that document. And also I'm putting on there your next writing assignment, which is basically saying, okay, now go do this, apply this method I just explained to you to something of your choosing. I've given you a wide range of options. You can do a song, you can do a painting, you can do a poem, you can do a film, although, or a scene in a film and how that relates to the overall film like we just did with Platoon. So you have pick something you're interested in, right? Because you'll enjoy the assignment more and you'll get something out of it. And then literally asking you to do what we just did with the method, apply it to that thing you chose. A few things I do want to stress to you about this one. This is not a paper, okay? None of the assignments we've done so far are papers in the traditional sense. They're all skills you'll need for when you write a paper, okay? And they're all, specifically tailored to kind of work on one at a time. The first was summary. And then we took summary and added responding to writings on top. Okay, and then the third one we added doing two writings, which is something called synthesis. And now we're adding a different skill. We're saying, okay, now we're going to play with analysis. My goal is to do these smaller writing assignments and pieces so that when you get later in the semester and you get your paper assignment, to some extent, we're not necessarily writing a paper from scratch. We're starting to assemble, okay, and plug in these skills that we've already worked on individually rather than working on them all at once by having several paper assignments throughout the semester. So that's kind of the theory. So it's not a traditional paper, so don't think of it that way. Again, it's worth 60 points. So this is just a homework, it's not this is a homework assignment. I don't mean to say just, because then you say, oh, don't take it seriously. Take it seriously. But it's, don't get so anxious that you kind of get paralyzed. It's a 60-point homework assignment. That being said, I do expect some elements of a paper there. I expect you to have an introduction that introduces the thing that you're analyzing. If you go back to your textbook, page 23 talks to you about how you can have a summary for a visual object. Okay, so if you're like, well, how do I summarize a painting, say? Well, go reach out for page 23 and they give you a little bit of guidance on how to do that. I expect you to still have a thesis. Okay, and your thesis here would be the interpretation. And then I expect you to ground yourself in the text. Okay, that's a phrase you're going to hear me use a lot in the feedback you get from now on. And what that means is you're showing, like, I'm not saying, I didn't just say, Barnes wins in the fight for Chris's soul. I then went and showed you things in the film itself that led me to that interpretation. That's grounding yourself in the text. Okay, so that those are the things I'm going to want to see in your assignment, even though it's not a traditional full-on paper. Okay, and one last point about analysis, it's important to cover, is, and this can be kind of liberating and also kind of frightening at the same time, is when we're dealing with an analysis, there isn't a right and wrong answer. Okay, that's not quite what we're dealing with. What you want, the bar is your interpretation valid? Does your interpretation make sense based on how you handle details? And the better analysis is the one that explains more details. Okay, so that's how you decide, well, which interpretation is better or more well thought out. Well, how many details does this interpretation explain? Doesn't mean you have to explain every detail. I don't mean that, but I mean, your interpretation, does it provide an umbrella in which the most amount of details make sense? That's kind of the bar. So there isn't a right, it's not like you have to watch Platoon and say, oh, I have to get the right answer, the right reading of this poem or of this song. Can someone watch Platoon and get a different set of meaning out of the village scene and the underworld scene? Absolutely, they could. And then we decide if it makes sense based on how many details it seems to explain. So while there's no right answer, there clearly are wrong answers, right? I mean, you can't say Platoon is a movie about, I don't know, people discussing their favorite kinds of cheese. Okay, it's just not. This is not a film about the Kennedy assassination, right? It's not. It's a film about Vietnam and the structures of war and what it does to an individual. So there is a level at which things can be wrong, but once you, and it's pretty low, once you pass that, now we're in the realm of valid. So don't think of it in terms of I have to explain this the right way. That's not quite what we do. You have to provide an interpretation, again, that covers the most details, that makes sense of the most details. So I think that's all I have to say about Platoon. Hopefully this made some sense to you. And if not, feel free to shoot me an email or watch this again or whatever. And again, remember, now that we have a camera in the office, we can start doing Zoom office hours if that's something that you ever need and you can't get to campus. Failing that, great seeing you. I will have those assignments up in a little bit here. And I hope you guys have a great rest of the week.